We'll get started. So, Bernie, without further ado,
Okay. Who are you? I think you said an extra 30 seconds to kind of introduce ourselves, too.
Sure, absolutely.
Okay, so my name is Bernie Dehler. I'm going to talk about a little bit more about my background during this, but I'm a former Christian. I'm an atheist now, and I organize a Center for Philosophical Naturalism as a worldview. And basically, after I left Christianity and became an atheist, it was very tempting just to live my life and go back into the shadows and forget about religion and everything, but I decided to share it with my family. I thought, well, maybe I should share what I've learned with other people also. And so another benefit is that I could remember why I left the faith, because it's such an important decision, because I'd hate to forget why I left and then say, oh my gosh, I become a Christian again. So it's kind of, because it's such a big question, it's kind of nice to go even more detail and make sure that I made the right decision. So that's one reason why I kind of do this stuff. Okay, so I guess I'll begin now. I have some slides here. So some of my introduction. And I'm going to talk about Gerry a little bit during my presentation, because we know each other. I used to believe, like Gerry and other Christians, that I used to celebrate the birth of Jesus around Christmas time. I used to be kind of disappointed that my family, you know, was in the Santa and all that stuff. It's like, this is supposed to be about the birthday of Jesus. I tried to bring that to my family a little bit. I come from a large family of 12 kids, by the way, a Roman Catholic family. I used to say I had the inner witness of the Holy Spirit. I felt like God led me, that I communicated with God. I felt a relationship with God. I felt the love of God. Anything that you hear an evangelical Christian say, they have a relationship with God. I had the same exact words, the same exact feelings, I believe. If I don't have those feelings, then neither do you if you claim to have those feelings. And the problem is I learned more science and philosophy, and so now I believe that the God hypothesis has been falsified. This is the hypothesis that there's a God that exists and has done certain things. So I'm here to change your mind and help educate anyone willing to learn. I feel like I've been educated, and that's why I left the faith. Some more introduction. I was raised and confirmed as a Roman Catholic up until college. After college, I became born again through the Four Spiritual Laws booklet. If you know that booklet, I really loved it. I memorized the Four Spiritual Laws. I've shared the Four Spiritual Laws. I've taught other people. I led people, tried to lead people to Christ. I had a little bit of success. For over 25 years, I was an evangelical Christian, born-again evangelical Christian after college. I preached the gospel on TV and the internet in a ministry I founded. While I was working full-time in the computer business, which I'm still working in, I got a master's degree from a conservative Baptist seminary, and I became an atheist in 2009, 5 years ago, 2 years after I graduated, not 2000. Not that old yet. So preliminary remarks. I want to say a word about a delusion. Some people think a delusion is name-calling, and I just want to make the point that I don't think delusion is name-calling. I think we're all deluded to some aspect. Delusion just means that you are not seeing reality correctly. And since nobody knows reality 100% correctly, everybody's got some wrong ideas. And if you really believe that's the way reality is, then you've got some delusion. And I think some people have more delusion than others. But so I don't think it's an insult to say you're deluded as if you have, you know, like you're mentally sick or something. I think it's just a fact of life. We're all deluded to some degree or another, and some more than others. So I just want to try to take some of the venom out of that word, and let's just all admit that we all have delusions to some point. And I also think there's this thing called a God delusion that I used to be a part of. Now, I want to say if the Bible God does exist, I'm deluded. I fully admit it. If God exists, I'm deluded. If the Bible God exists, I'm deluded. If the Bible God does not exist, then Gerry and all the other Christians in here are deluded if they think they feel a presence with this being that doesn't exist. So that's just kind of a basic fact. And I want to say some things about Gerry. I want to make clear, I think he's smart, nice, and friendly. Okay, there's no doubt about it. He's a very loving person. So this is not an attack on Gerry. Anything I have to say, I want to make it all intellectual, okay? But I do think he's wrong and naive on certain things about science and philosophy. I'm going to talk about that. And I'm sure he knows more about theology than I do, because he's got a Ph.D. in theology and he teaches theology. So he should know a lot more than I do. But, you know, some atheists say, you know, that doesn't mean anything to me. That's kind of like somebody who knows everything about Star Wars, who, you know, or Santa Claus. You know, people want to argue if Santa Claus has three buttons on a suit or five buttons. Who cares, you know? So they see that's the way theology is. Like, who cares how much they know about imaginary gods? You know, it doesn't mean anything to me. So anyway, I just say I don't think the Bible God exists in heaven with angels any more than Santa Claus lives at the North Pole in a toy factory with elves. And I'm not saying that to ridicule you, because it's actually the truth. I really do not believe God exists, just like you all believe Santa Claus does not exist. I have the same strong conviction that God does not exist, especially the God of the Bible. And, you know, I'll talk about that later. So now we're here to talk about Christmas. What's Christmas all about? Christians claim that the creator of the world, Jesus, became incarnate, which means he took on human flesh, became a creature, and he dwelt among us. You know, and this is like, for example, in the Gospel of John, the Word became flesh and made his dwelling among us. Okay, so, you know, part of the elements of that story is that God becomes a man. There's a virgin who became pregnant. A virgin means she's never had sex. So this is truly a miracle that a woman never had sex, but yet she's pregnant. And she gives birth, and there's angels announcing this birth to the shepherds, which, of course, is a bunch of miracles, because there's angels that exist now, and they're contacting the shepherds. Three wise men, that's pretty important to have three wise men. You must be an important person if three wise men are going to, you know, go across the world to try to find you, and they're following you by a star, so that's pretty incredible too. So there's a lot of incredible things going on here. So why would a God become a man? That's an interesting thing to think about. Why would God become a man? There's got to be a lot of strong motive for that, right? I mean, he wouldn't say, hey, I'm bored, I'm going to become a man. There's got to be a big reason to become a man. So in the Christian version, Jesus made the humans because Jesus is the creator of everything. It says in the Bible, especially Gospel of John, humans sinned. So gods, and I have the apostrophe wrong here because I don't know the plural and singular. It's hard to say if God's a plural or singular because he's three persons yet one being. So it's kind of, you know, mixed up there. So anyway, God, the wrath of God the Father is placed on all humans because of human sin. And then a human sacrifice appeases God's wrath. It talks about God's wrath is upon us, and that's appeased through the sacrifice of Christ. So, you know, one interesting way to say that is God ended up sacrificing himself to appease himself. And this is from a God who's said to be omniscient, which is all-knowing. So at the very start of the foundation, God knows everything. He knew that he was going to make a creation, it was going to fall, get messed up, and he's going to have to go down there and become a human and die on the cross. I mean, it's just kind of an interesting way to look at all this. Of course, the way the Bible's written, it's like God figured things out, like, oh my gosh, people are so wicked, for example, Noah's flood, I'm going to wipe them out. You know, it's kind of makes it appear like God figured these things out. But in modern philosophy, the philosopher's God, they say God's got to be all-knowing, so supposedly he knows all that. So that's just some problems coming up. So human sacrifice, is that biblical? Well, it kind of depends. In one passage, it's interesting, God says he detests child sacrifice, and it's something that never entered his mind. And this is in Jeremiah. So this happened after even he told Abraham to sacrifice his own son Isaac. So it's kind of how do those two things work together? And another passage, it says Jesus was slain from the foundation of the world from the very beginning. So that means God knew about this. So if God's all-knowing and he fully knew this, why does he say, hey, I detest child sacrifice, as something that never entered my mind? It doesn't seem to add up there. So here's the passages in Jeremiah. It says, God says, they have built the high places of Baal to burn their children and the fire as offerings to Baal, something I did not command or mention, nor did it enter my mind. And then in Revelation 13:8 there, it says, all that dwell upon the earth shall worship him whose names are not written in the book of life of the Lamb, slain from the foundation of the world. So that's just where that came from. So can God become a human? Let's think about that for a little bit. Many religions say yes, of course. You know, in Christianity, God Almighty incarnates as man, and this is celebrated at Christmas time. In Hinduism, just as another data point, much older than Christianity. In fact, it's so old they don't even know who wrote the scriptures. Vishnu has incarnated many times as different creatures, and they call these avatars. If you heard of the word avatars, I talked to some kids about Avatar, and it's like, do you know what an Avatar is? Oh, yeah, it's like Avatar the Last Airbender. It's like, no. Avatar, yeah, it's a movie. It's a big blue guy. No. This is Avatar the noun. This is when a Hindu god becomes some kind of a creature, and like a human. Muslims don't believe God, that Jesus was God and came from heaven, but they do have their own funny beliefs. They have a verse here where Mary carries the infant, and they go, "Oh, Mary, how did this happen to you?" And she points to the infant, and they go, "What? He can't talk for himself." And he pops up, and he says, "Behold, I'm a servant of God." And he has a speech here. It's like, you know, he says, "He has given me the scripture and made me a prophet and made me blessed wherever I may be. And he has enjoined upon me prayer and charity as long as I live, and has endowed me with piety towards my mother. And he has not made me haughty or bereft of grace. Hence, peace was upon me on the day I was born, and will be upon me on the day of my death, and on the day when I shall be raised to life again." Isn't that interesting to see an infant say all that? It's like, wow, I mean, how did he even learn those words and not only that, but what it means? And then did he just go right back to suckling again after he said all that? It's kind of, you know, it seems kind of strange. So how can people believe these kind of stories? Are they simply born into it? A person born in the USA now has an 80% chance of being a Christian. There's 320 million people in our population. But open your eyes and look at the whole world. If you're in India, there's an 80% chance of being a Hindu. There's 1.2 billion there. That's four times as many, the population, about the same percentage, 80% Hindu. So think about that. I mean, they're just as convinced about Vishnu as you are about Jesus. And then in Morocco, for example, there's 32 million, and there's a 99.9% chance of being Muslim there. So, you know, consider that, and consider whether you are just following the trend about where you're born. You know, we need to seek the truth. I think we all agree about this, and overcome our starting points. Here's 10 of the avatars of Vishnu. Vishnu is a Hindu god, and according to some different sects of Islam, these are some of his incarnations, and there's two or three of theirs as humans, you know, and also a human slash lion. And by the way, number 10, the Kalki, that's the last avatar yet to appear. Religious texts foretell that he will be atop a white horse with a drawn blazing sword. He's a harbinger of the end time in Hindu eschatology, after which he will usher in a golden age. Sounds familiar, doesn't it? If you know about Revelation, the book of Revelation, it sounds very, very familiar. The real Jesus. You know, you can look at artwork and see a lot of different kind of Jesuses, and sometimes the black people have a black Jesus, and I don't know if Asians have an Asian Jesus, and it looks like a lot of Jesuses are white, and you wonder, was Jesus really white? Just to tell you, this is kind of a joke, but there was a four-year-old watching this parade one time, and Santa was coming into town, and the news report says, "Hey, aren't you, did you show Santa your, are you excited to show Santa your list, your what you want for Christmas?" And she says, "No." And he goes, "Well, are you going to?" And she says, "No." And he says, "Why not?" And she says, "Because that's not the real Santa. The real Santa's at the mall." So the point here is that there's all kinds of Santas, right? Well, there's a lot of kind of Jesuses, too. And so that's one thing I want to bring up now. These are some things about the nativity stories. This is from Bart Ehrman, okay? This Bart Ehrman says this is something, he's a former Christian also, but he's a Bible teacher, and he's written a lot of books. Like, one of his latest books is called Forged, about how many of the Bible books are forgeries. You know, they say they're written by so-and-so and they're not. It's kind of like these are the things they don't tell you in church, but a lot of the scholars know about it. I'm sure Gerry would argue with that too, but anyway, that's a really interesting book. I think if you really want to be shocked by a Christian scholar, look at that book called Forged. Anyway, this is something he says he talks to his students about. He says, let's read the narratives and see what's going on there. Let's see if we can make these things work out, reconcile them. And of course, you only have Matthew and Luke, because Mark and John say absolutely zero about his nativity. There's no story whatsoever about how he was born. So the similarities is Jesus is born in Bethlehem. His mother is a virgin. After his birth, he's visited by a group of men, in one case shepherds in Luke, and it's wise men in Matthew. They have been alerted to his birth by a heavenly sign, an angel in Luke, a miraculous sign in Matthew. And eventually he's taken to Nazareth and raised, and that's where he grows up. So here's some differences, but they're not contradictions outright. Luke mentions the shepherds, but not the magi, the wise men. And Matthew mentions the magi, but not the shepherds. So some people say, well, maybe they're both true, and one just gave half the story. This is where it's difficult to impossible to reconcile. Matthew, and by the way, Bart Ehrman says too, after he does this exercise with the students, he says, now let's watch some of these typical Christian movies and see what they picked, you know, to tell the story. So here's some difficult to impossible differences to reconcile. Matthew says Joseph and Mary's original hometown was Bethlehem, not Nazareth. So there was no traveling to get to Bethlehem. They always lived in Bethlehem. So like Luke says, there's a census. They had to go to Bethlehem, but no. In Matthew, he's just living there. And then some 2 years later in Matthew, the Magi come to worship him at his house in Bethlehem. And then Joseph and his family have to escape to Egypt to avoid Herod's wrath. And when Herod dies, they're ready to come back, but they can't return because the next guy who's king is just as worse as his father. So the couple's forced to go to Nazareth. So basically in Matthew, Jesus' parents live in Bethlehem, and then they flee to Egypt, and then they can't come back to Bethlehem, so they relocate to Nazareth. In Luke, Mary and Joseph are not from Bethlehem. They're from Nazareth, and they have to go to Bethlehem to register for this alleged census. I think Bart says there's no evidence of this census at all. I'm not sure about that, but I think so. So basically, they have to travel, the story says, to go to Bethlehem to register. Mary happens to have Jesus while there. And Luke is clear that after 32 days, when Mary performs her ritual cleansing, they return to Nazareth. So they came from Nazareth and go back to Nazareth. So if that's true, how can Matthew be right that they fled to Egypt? And there's no mention of Egypt. So if you and this is one thing that Bart also says. He says, one warning, you can always find a way to harmonize these things by trying to mishmash things that aren't in one or the other. But he says, when you're doing that, you're creating a new gospel. You're creating another version when you're doing that. Just be intellectually honest and know what you're doing. You're creating a new story that did not exist before. And that's what, remember I showed the pictures of the different Jesus pictures? So what you're doing is when you make these stories merge together, you're creating another story. How much time do I have?
4 minutes.
4 minutes. Just some interesting data points to remember. This is one thing Bart Ehrman says, is that the Gospels are written anonymously. Nobody really knows who wrote them. There's tradition says they were written by so-and-so, but he says some of the best scholars that they would admit that they're anonymous. There's some interesting things. I think I'm gonna skip some of this, but there's some interesting things I'll just mention real quickly. The Apostle Paul says he learned the gospel directly through the vision from the risen Jesus, taught by no man. And this is some things like Richard Carey, he doesn't believe there was a historical Jesus, probably. And he's got a lot of material in here. And whether you believe it or not, it's his thesis. It's a lot of interesting information there that he goes through, people cite Josephus, so he talks about Josephus as a historian and all this. So anyway, the epistles from Paul are actually the oldest manuscripts, and that means they're the first documents, and the Gospels are actually dated after that. So it could be, he says, that the Gospels were written from a lot of Paul's stuff. So it turned out that when Paul was starting the religion, he really hyped how he was taught by vision, but then as time came on, it became more important to say, oh, well, we have history here. We have historical narratives. And so you might wonder, well, if they had these historical narratives all along, Paul wouldn't have argued that he had visions. He would have argued, hey, I know the real people. I know the real stuff. But he never did that. He basically said, I don't care who these pillars of the church are, and I learned directly from Jesus. And even though he didn't know Jesus, you know, he had visions of Jesus that taught him. Okay. And then just consider everything, and there's other biblical myths too to consider. For example, special creation. I think evolution says, well, we know we evolved from other animals. Gerry rejects evolution. Okay, so I think if he were to understand that evolution shows that the creation story and there's a myth, that would help him reinterpret other Bible passages. And that's what happened to me. Same with Noah's flood. It's obviously a myth, but Gerry thinks Noah's flood is a real event and there was a real Noah and a real ark and all that. I think, again, if he knew that, he wouldn't be like that. And then Nancy Murphy is one of his peers at Fuller Theological Seminary. And one time they asked her, you know, what do you think about this Darwin's theory, you know, in light of all this Christian opposition to it? And she says, when I first discovered there are still Christians who reject evolutionary theory, I thought it was a harmless expression of ignorance. More recently, though, I've come to see it as tragic. Vast numbers of young people are taught that evolution and Christianity can't both be true. They get a good science education in college, recognize the truth of the evolutionary picture, and then believe they can have to reject their faith. And so I think Gerry is part of the problem here, because he's one of these guys teaching at the PhD level that evolution theory is weak or is not valid and something good to be with.
30 seconds.
Okay. So another interesting thing too, I'll just bring up is that, well, okay, I'll just end here that when I became when I adopted the naturalistic worldview that there's nothing supernatural, a lot of mysteries went away. I didn't say, oh, well, that's a good question. I guess when I die, I'll ask God and all my answers will be solved. It's like, wow, when you have a naturalistic worldview, all your answers are solved. All these problems go away. And you don't have to believe ridiculous things like there's three persons of God, but there's only one God. And it's like, huh, how's that work? I mean, nobody knows. It's a mystery. You'll find out in heaven someday. So that's it.
Done?
Right. Yep.
All right, sir.
Okay.